Next, a black ghetto family in Chicago contemplates a move into an all-white neighborhood in the classic award-winning drama, A Raisin in the Sun, on the season premiere of American Playhouse here on TV 25.
Join us now for the premiere presentation of American Playhouse's 8th season. A Mother's Dreams.
Been thinking we maybe could meet the notes on a little old two-story somewhere.
A Son's Ambition.
Baby, this ain't no fly-by-night proposition.
A Family's Anguish and Triumph.
Mama, there ain't no colored people living in Clybourne Park.
Danny Glover and Esther Rolle star in an American masterpiece. The world premiere, complete and uncut for the first time ever. Lorraine Hansberry's A Raisin in the Sun, next on American Playhouse. The presentation of American Playhouse is made possible by the nation's public television stations, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the National Endowment for the Arts, and by the Chubb Group of Insurance Companies, for over 100 years providing business and personal insurance worldwide through independent agents and brokers. Additional funding for A Raisin in the Sun was provided by the Ambassador International Cultural Foundation.
In the world, they got to use a bathroom. Walter Lee, it's after 7:30. Let me see you doing some waking up in there now. You better get on up from there, man. It's after 7:30, I tell you. All right, you just go ahead and lay there. Next thing you know, Travis will be finished. Mr. Johnson gonna be in there, and you'll be fussing and cussing around here like a madman and be late, too. Walter Lee, it is time for you to get up!
Out yet?
What you mean, out? He ain't hardly got in there good yet.
What you doing all that yelling for if I can't even get in there yet? Check coming today?
They say it's Saturday. This is just Friday. I hopes to God you ain't gonna be getting up here first thing this morning, start talking to me about no money, because I about don't want to hear it.
Is something the matter with you this morning?
No, I'm just sleepy as the devil. What kind of eggs you want?
Not scrambled. Paper come? Set off another egg bomb yesterday.
See it there.
What's the matter with you?
Ain't nothing the matter with me, and don't keep asking me that this morning.
Ain't nobody bothering you. Says, Colonel McCormick is sick.
Is he now? Poor thing.
Look, been in that bathroom all this time. He just gonna have to start getting up earlier. I can't be being late to work on account of him fooling around in there.
Oh, no, he ain't gonna be getting up no earlier, no such thing. Ain't his fault he can't get to bed no earlier nights. So he got a bunch of crazy, good-for-nothing clowns sitting up running their mouths in what's supposed to be his bedroom after 10 o'clock at night.
That's just the matter with you, huh? It ain't it. The things I want to talk about with my friends just couldn't be important to your mind, could they?
Always got to smoke before you eat in the morning.
Just look at them down there. Just running around, racing to work. This morning, baby.
Yeah?
Just for a second, stirring the maize. Just for a second it was. You look real young again. Mm. It's gone now. You look like yourself again.
Man, if you don't shut up and leave me alone.
The first thing a man ought to learn in life is not to make love to no colored woman first thing in the morning. Y'all some evil people at 8 o'clock in the morning.
Hey, come on. Sit down and have your breakfast, Travis.
Mama, this is Friday. Check coming around, huh?
You get your mind off of money and eat your breakfast.
This is the moment we're supposed to bring 50 cents to school.
Well, I ain't got no 50 cents this morning.
Teacher said we have to.
I don't care what teachers say, I ain't got it. Now go eat your breakfast, Travis.
I'm gonna eat it.
Hush up then and just eat.
You think Grandmama would have it?
No, and I want you to stop asking your Grandmama for money. You hear me?
Golly, I don't ask her. She just give me it sometime.
Travis Woolard Younger, I got too much on me this morning.
Baby Daddy.
Travis!
Can I maybe go carry some groceries and come to the supermarket after school then?
Just hush, I said. Travis. If you're through eating, then you can get on over there and make up your bed.
I'm gone.
Come here. Boy, if you don't take this comb and fix this here head, you better. You about to march out of here with that head looking like chicken slept in it. Just don't know where you get your slobbering ways. I'm gone. Get your jacket, too. It looks chilly out this morning. Get your car fare and your lunch money. Not a single penny for no caps. You hear me?
Yes.
Oh, Mama makes me so mad sometimes. I don't know what to do. I wouldn't kiss that woman goodbye this morning, not for nothing in this world. Not for nothing in this world. Now, who's little old angry man of you?
Golly, Mom.
Oh, golly, Mom. Get on out of here, Sugar. You're going to be...
Oh, Mama! Could I please go carry groceries?
Honey, it's starting to get so cold even.
What is it he wants to do?
Go carry groceries at the supermarket.
Oh, well, let him go.
I have to. She won't give me the 50 cents.
Why not?
Because we don't have it.
What you tell a boy things like that for? Here, son.
Thanks, Daddy.
In fact... There's another 50 cents. Buy yourself some fruit today. Take a taxi cab to school or something. You better get down now and get to school, man.
Okay. Bye.
That's my boy. Wanna know what I was thinking about in the bathroom this morning?
No.
How come you always try to be so pleasant?
But is there to be pleasant, Val?
You wanna know what I was thinking about in the bathroom or not?
I know what you was thinking, Val.
About what me and Willie Harris was talking about last night.
Willie Harris is a good-for-nothing loudmouth.
Anybody who talks to me has got to be a good-for-nothing loudmouth, ain't he? And what do you know about who's a good-for-nothing loudmouth? Now, Charlie Akins was just a good-for-nothing loudmouth, too, wasn't he? When he wanted me to go in the dry-cleaning business with him. Now he's grossing $100,000 a year. $100,000. You still call him a good-for-nothing loudmouth?
Oh, Walter Lee.
You're tired, ain't you, baby? You're tired of everything. And me, the boy, the way we live, it's beat up whole, everything, ain't you? So tired, moaning and groaning all the time. But you wouldn't do nothing to help, would you? You couldn't be on my side that long for nothing, could you?
Walter, leave me alone.
A man needs a woman to back him up.
Walter!
Mama would listen to you. Hey, you know she'd listen to you more than she'd do me and Benny. She'd think more of you. Now, all you have to do when you sit down with her and you drink your coffee and talking about things like you do, and you sip your coffee, see, and say easy, like, that you've been thinking about the deal that Walter Lee's so interested in, about the store and all. And then you sip some more coffee. Like what you're saying ain't really that important to you. And next thing you know, she's listening good and asking you questions. And when I come home, I can tell her all the details. Baby, this ain't no fly-by-night proposition. I mean, we figured it out, me, Willie, and Bobo.
Bobo?
Yeah. You see, this little liquor store costs $75,000. We figured initial investment on the place be $30,000, see? That's $10,000 each. Of course, there's a couple of hundred you gotta pay so you don't spend your life waiting on them clowns to get your license approved.
You mean graft?
Oh, don't call it that. You see that? That just goes to show you what a woman understands about the world. Baby, don't nothing happen for you in this world unless you pay somebody off.
Walter, leave me alone. Eat your eggs. They're gonna be cold.
You see that? Man says, this woman, I got a dream. This woman says, eat your eggs. Man says, I gotta take hold of this here world, baby. And a woman will say, eat your eggs and go to work. Man says, I gotta change my life. I'm choking to death, baby. And this woman says, your eggs is getting cold.
Walter, that ain't none of our money.
This morning, I'm looking in the mirror, and I'm thinking about it. I'm 35 years old. I've been married 11 years, and I got a boy who sleeps in the living room. And all I got to give him is nothing. Nothing but stories about how rich white people live.
Eat your eggs, Walter.
Damn them eggs. Damn all the eggs that ever was.
Then go to work.
See that? I'm trying to talk to you about me, and all you can say is eat them eggs and go to work.
Honey, you never say nothing new. I listen to you every day, every night, every morning. You never say nothing new. So you would rather be Mr. Arnold than be a chauffeur, so I would rather be living in Buckingham Palace.
And that's just what's wrong with the colored women in the world. Don't understand about building the men up, making them feel like they're somebody, like they can do something.
There are colored men who do things.
Yeah, no thanks to the colored woman.
Well, being a colored woman, I guess I can't help myself. No.
Yeah, we're just a group of men tied to a race of women with small minds.
I am going to start timing those people.
You should get up earlier.
Really? Would you suggest dawn?
Where's the paper?
You sure one horrible-looking chick at this hour.
Good morning, everybody.
How's school coming?
Lovely.
Lovely.
And you know biology is the greatest. I dissected something that looked just like you yesterday.
I was just wondering if you made up your mind and everything.
And what did I answer yesterday morning and the day before that?
Don't be so nasty, Ben.
And the day before that, and the day before that.
I'm interested in you. Something wrong with that? Ain't many girls decide to be a doctor. Have we figured out yet just exactly how much medical school's gonna cost?
Come on out of there, please!
Walter Lee, why don't you leave that girl alone and get out here to work?
You know, the check's coming tomorrow.
That money belongs to Mama, Walter, and it's for her to decide how she wants to use it. I don't care if she wants to buy a house or a rocket ship or just nail it up somewhere and look at it. It's hers, not ours, hers.
Now, ain't that fine? You just got your mother's interest at heart, ain't you, girl? You're such a nice girl. But Mama can always take a few thousand to help you through school, can't she?
I have never asked anyone around here to do anything for me.
No, but the line between asking and just accepting when the time comes is big and wide, ain't it?
Then what do you want from me, brother, that I quit school or just drop dead? Which?
I don't want nothing except for you to stop acting holy around here. Now, me and Ruth to make some sacrifices for you. Why can't you do something for the family?
Walter, don't be dragging me in it.
You are in it. Don't you get up and go to work in somebody's kitchen to help put clothes on her back?
Oh, Walter, that's not fair.
It ain't that we expect you to get down on your knees and say, thank you, brother, thank you, Ruth, thank you, Mama, and thank you, Travis, for wearing the same pair of shoes for the last two semesters.
Well, I do all right. Thank everybody, and forgive me for ever wanting to be anything at all. Forgive me, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me. Please, stop it. Your Mama hear you.
And who the hell told you you had to be a doctor? If you're so crazy about messing around sick people, then be a nurse like other women, or get married or shut up.
Well, you finally got it said. It took you 3 years, but you finally got it said. Well, to give up, leave me alone. It's Mama's money.
He was my father, too.
So what? He was mine, too, and Travis's grandfather, but the insurance money belongs to Mama. Picking on me is not going to make her give it to you to invest in any liquor store. And I, for one, say God bless Mama for that.
Did you hear? Did you hear?
Yes, honey, Connie, just please, go to work.
Nobody in this house is ever going to understand me.
Because you're a nut.
Hey, who's a nut?
You. You are a nut. V is mad, boy.
Yeah, the most backward race of people, and that's a fact.
And then there are all those prophets who would lead us out of the wilderness. Into the swamp! Benny, why you always got to be picking on your brother? Can't you be a little sweeter sometime?
I need some money for carfare.
$0.50? Here. Take a taxi.
Who's that around here slamming doors at this hour?
That was Walter Lee. He and Benny was at it again.
My children and their tempers. Lord, if this little old plant don't get more sun than it's been getting, it ain't never gonna see spring again.
What's the matter with you this morning, Ruth? You looks right peaked.
You aiming to iron all them things? Leave some of them for me. I'll get to them this afternoon. Benny? Honey, it's too drafty for you to be sitting around here half-dressed. Where's your robe?
In the cleaners.
Well, go get mine and put it on.
I'm not cold, Mama, honest.
I know, honey, but you're so thin.
Mama, I'm not cold.
Lord, have mercy. Look at this poor bed. Bless his heart. He tries, don't he?
No. He don't half try at all, because he know you're going to come along behind him and fix everything. That's just how come he don't know how to do nothing right now. You done spoiled that boy so.
Well, he's just a little old boy. He ain't supposed to know about housekeeping. My baby, that's what he is.
Don't you feed him for breakfast?
I feed my son, Lena.
I ain't meddling. I just noticed all last week he had cold cereal. When it starts to get this chilly in the fall, a child ought to have some hot grits or something when he goes out.
I gave him hot oats. Is that all right?
I ain't meddling. Put a lot of nice butter on it. He likes lots of butter.
Lena.
What was you and your brother fussing about?
It's not important, Mama.
What were they fighting about?
Now, you know as well as I do.
Walter Lee's still worrying himself sick about that money.
You know he is.
You have breakfast?
Some coffee.
Girl, you better start eating and looking after yourself better. Almost thin as Travis.
Lena?
Mm-hmm.
What you gonna do with it?
Now, don't you start, child. It's too early in the morning to be talking about money. Besides, it ain't Christian.
Well, it's just that he got his heart set on that store.
You mean that liquor store that Willie Harris wanted him to invest in?
Yes, ma'am.
We ain't no business people, Ruth. We just plain working folks.
Well, ain't nobody business people till they go into business. Walter Lee say that colored people ain't gonna never start getting ahead till they start gambling on some different kinds of things in the world, like investments and things.
What's done got into you, girl? Walter Lee done finally sold you on investing?
No. Mama, something is happening between Walter and me, and I don't know what it is. He needs something. Something I can't give him anymore. He needs this chance, Lena.
But liquor, honey?
Well, like Walter says, but people go always be drinking themselves some liquor.
Well, whether they drinks it or not ain't none of my business, but whether I sell it to them is. And I don't want that on my ledger this late in life. Ruth Younger, what is the matter with you today? You look like you could fall over right there.
I'm tired.
Then you better stay home from work.
I can't stay home. She be calling up the agency. My girl didn't come in. Oh, send me somebody. My girl didn't come in. She just have a fit.
Let her have it. I just call up and say you get the flu.
Why the flu?
Because it sounds respectable to them. It's something white people get, too. They know about the flu. Otherwise, they think you've been cut up or something when you tell them you're sick.
Well, I gotta go in. We need the money.
Lord have mercy. Somebody would have thought my children done all but starved to death the way they talk about money here lately. Girl, we got a great big old check coming tomorrow.
Now, that's your money. Ain't got nothing to do with me, and we all feel like that, Walter, Benny, me, even Travis.
$10,000.
Sure is wonderful.
$10,000.
You know what you should do, Miss Lena?
Mm.
You should take yourself a trip somewhere to Europe or South America someplace.
Oh, child.
I'm serious. Just pack up and leave. Now, you forget about the family, and you go and have yourself a ball for once in your life.
You sound like I'm about ready to die. You'll go with me. But I look like wandering around Europe by myself.
Shoot, these here rich white women do it all the time. They don't think nothing of packing up their suitcases and piling on one of them big steamships and swoosh, they gone, child.
Something always told me I wasn't no rich white woman.
Well, what you gonna do with it then?
I ain't rightly decided. Of course, some of it got to be put away for Bonita's medical school, and ain't nothing gonna touch that part of it. Nothing. Been thinking we maybe could meet the notes on a little old two-story somewhere with a yard where Travis could play in the summertime. If we use part of that money as a down payment and everybody else kind of pitch in, I could maybe take on a little day work again.
Well, Lord knows we done put enough rent to this here rat trap. I pay 4 hours by now.
Rat trap. Yeah, that's all it is. I
remembers just as well the day me and Big Walter moved in here, though. Hadn't been married but 2 weeks. Wasn't planning on living here more than a year. We was gonna set aside, little by little, don't you know, and pass a little place out in Morgan Park. Even picked out the house. Looks right dumpy today, but Lord, child, you should know all the dreams I had about buying that place and fixing it up and making me a little garden in the back. Did none of that happen?
Yes, life can be a barrel of disappointment sometimes.
Johnny Big Walter used to come in here some nights back then and slump down on that couch there. Just look at the rug and look at me. Look at the rug and then back at me, and I'd know he was down then, really down. And Lord, child, when I lost that baby, little Claude, I almost thought I was gonna lose Big Walter too. Oh, that man grieved himself. He was one man to love his children.
Nothing can tear at you like losing your baby.
I reckon that's how come that man finally worked himself to death like he done. Like he was fighting his own war against this here world that took his baby from him.
He sure was a fine man, all right. Always liked Mr. Younger.
Crazy about his children. God knows there was plenty wrong with Walter Younger. Hard-headed, mean, kind of wild with the women. Plenty wrong with him. But he sure loved his children. Always wanted them to have something, be something. That's where brother get them notions from, I reckon. Big Walter used to say, he'd get right wet in the eyes, lean his head back with the water standing in his eyes and say, seemed like God didn't see fit to give the black man nothing but dreams. But he did give us children to make them dreams seem worthwhile. Mm-hmm. He could talk like that, don't you know?
Yes, he sure could. He was a good man, Mr. Younger.
Yes, a fine man. Just couldn't ever catch up with his dreams, that's all.
Be so dirty on that woman's rug, she has to vacuum them every single day.
I wish a certain young woman round here I could name would take inspiration about certain rugs in a certain apartment I could also mention.
How much cleaning can a house need, for Christ's sake?
Penny.
Just listen to her. Just listen.
Oh, God.
If you use the Lord's name just one more time.
Oh, Mama.
Fresh, just fresh as salt, this girl.
Well, if the salt loses, it saves.
Now, that will do. I just ain't gonna have you around here reciting the scripture in vain, you hear me?
How did I manage to get on everybody's wrong side by just walking into a room?
If you weren't so fresh.
Look, I am 20 years old.
What time you be home from school this evening?
Kind of late. Madeline is going to start my guitar lessons.
Your what kind of lessons?
Guitar.
Oh, Father.
How come you done taken it into your mind to learn to play the guitar?
I just want to, that's all.
Oh, child, don't you know what to do with yourself? How long it's gonna be before you get tired of this now? Like you got tired of that little play-acting group you joined last year. What was it the year before that?
Horseback riding club, for which she bought that $55 riding habit that's been hanging in the closet ever since.
Why you got to flip so from one thing to another, baby?
I just want to learn to play the guitar. Is anything wrong with that?
Ain't nobody trying to stop you. I just wonders why you has to flip so from one thing to another. You ain't never done nothing with all that camera equipment you bought.
I don't flip. I experiment with different forms of expression.
Like riding a horse?
People have to express themselves one way or another.
What is it you want to express?
Me!
Don't
don't worry. I don't expect you to understand.
Who are you going out with tomorrow?
George Murchison again.
Oh, you getting a little sweet on him.
Yes, me this, Charlie. Sweet on nobody but herself. Express us. Like George, all right, Mama. I mean, I like him enough to go out with him and stuff, but
what does Ann stuff mean?
Mind your own business.
Quit picking on her now, Ruth. What does it mean?
I just mean I could never really be serious about George. He's so shallow.
Shallow? What you mean he's shallow? He's rich.
Sure.
I know he's rich. He knows he's rich, too.
Well, what other qualities a man got to have to satisfy you, little girl?
You wouldn't even begin to understand. Anybody who married Walter could not possibly understand.
Now, what kind of way is that for you to talk about your brother?
Brother's a flip, let's face it.
What's a flip?
She's saying he's crazy. No, not crazy. Brother isn't really crazy yet. He's an elaborate neurotic.
That's your mom.
As for George, George looks good. He's got a beautiful car. He takes me to nice places. I even like him sometimes. But if the youngers are sitting around waiting to see if their little Benny is going to tie up the family with the Murchisons, they're wasting their time.
You mean you wouldn't marry George Murchison even if he asked you someday? That pretty rich thing? Honey? I knew you was up.
No, I would not marry him if all I felt for him is what I feel now. Besides, George's family wouldn't really like it.
Why not?
Oh, Mama. The Murchisons are honest to God, real, live, rich colored people. And the only people in the world who are more snobbish than rich white people are rich colored people. Well, I thought everybody knew that. I have met Mrs. Murchison. Woo! She's a scene.
You must not dislike people because they're well off, honey.
Why not? It makes just as much sense as disliking people because they're poor. And lots of people do that.
Well, she'll get over some of this.
Get over it. What are you talking about, Ruth? Listen, I am going to be a doctor. I'm not worried about who I'm going to marry yet. If I ever get married.
Ew. If. Now, Benny.
Oh, I probably will. But first, I am going to be a doctor. And George, for one, still thinks that's pretty funny. Well, I couldn't be bothered with that. I am going to be a doctor, and everybody around here better understand that.
Of course you're going to be a doctor, honey. God willing.
God hasn't got a thing to do with it.
But Nathan, that just wasn't necessary.
No, neither's God. I get sick of hearing about God.
But Nathan!
I mean it. I am just tired of hearing about God all the time. What has he got to do with anything? Does he pay tuition?
You just about to get your fresh little jaw slapped.
That's just what she needs.
Why? Why can't I say what I want to around here like everybody else?
It don't sound nice for young girls to say things like that. You wasn't brought up that way. Me and your daddy went to trouble to get you and brother to church every Sunday.
Mama, you don't understand. It's all a matter of ideas, and God is just one idea I don't accept. Well, it's not important. I'm not going out and be immoral or commit crimes because I don't believe in God. I don't even think about it. It's just that I get tired of him getting credit for all the things the human race achieves through its own stubborn effort. Well, there simply is no blasted God. There's only man, and it is he who makes miracles.
Now you say after me. In my mother's house, there is still God. In my mother's house, there is still God.
In my mother's house, there is still God.
There are some ideas we just ain't gonna have in this house. Not as long as I'm still the head of this family.
Yes, ma'am.
Benny?
You think you're a woman, but you're still a little girl. And what you did was childish, so you got treated like a child.
I see. I also see that everybody thinks it's all right for Mama to be a tyrant. And all the tyranny in the world will never put a god in the heavens.
She said she was sorry.
They frightens me, Ruth. My children.
You got good children, Lena. They're just a little off sometimes, but they're good.
No. There's something come down between me and them that don't let us understand each other, and I don't know what it is. One of them done almost lost his mind talking about money all the time. The other done commenced to talk about things that I can't seem to understand in no form or fashion. What is it that's changing, Ruth?
Now you're taking it all too seriously. You just got strong-willed children. And it takes a strong woman like you to keep them in hand.
They're spirited, all right, my children. Got to admit, they got spirit, Benny and Walter. Just like that little old plant that ain't never had enough sunshine or nothing, and look at it.
Sure loves that little old thing, don't you?
Well, I always wanted me a garden like the ones I used to see back of the houses down home. This here little plant is close as I ever got to having one. Lord, there ain't nothing as dreary as the view from this window on a dreary day, is there? Why ain't you singing now this morning, Ruth? Sing there, though. No ways tired. That song always lifts me up so. Ruth? Ruth, honey, what's the matter? Ruth!
Grandmama, that stuff Benny is using smells awful. Can I go downstairs, please?
You sure you finished all them chores already? I ain't seen you doing much.
Yes, I'm finished early. Where did Mama go this month?
She had to run a little errand.
Where?
To tend to her business.
Hello. Yes, he is. It's Willie Harris again.
Hello, Willie. Papers come back from the lawyer. Well, not yet. I told you, the mailman doesn't get here till 10:30. No, I'll come there. Yeah, right away.
Mother, where did Ruth go?
How should I know?
Better get over there behind the bureau. Seen one marching out of there like Napoleon yesterday.
Well, there's really only one way to get rid of her, Mama.
Yeah.
Set fire to this building. Mama, where did Ruth go?
To the doctor, I think.
The doctor? What's the matter with... You don't think she...
I ain't saying what I think. But I ain't never been wrong about no woman, neither.
Hello. I missed you. In my way. This morning. No. House cleaning and all that. Mama hates it if I let people come over when the house is like this.
That's right.
You have? Oh, well, that's different. What is it? Oh. What the hell? Come on over. Right. Arrivederci.
Who's that you inviting over here with this house looking like this? You ain't got the pride you was born with.
Oh, the guy doesn't care how houses look, Mama. He's an intellectual.
Who? Ostergaard, Joseph Ostergaard. He's an African boy I met on campus. He's been studying in Canada.
What's his name?
Ostergaard, Joseph Ostergaard.
Ooh, he's from Nigeria.
Oh, that's that little African country that was founded by the slaves way back.
No, Mama, that's Liberia.
But I don't think I never met no African before.
Well, do me a favor and don't ask him a whole lot of ignorant questions like, do they wear clothes?
Well, now, if you think we're so ignorant around here, maybe you shouldn't invite your friends here.
It's just that all anybody ever seems to know about when it comes to Africa is Tarzan.
Why should I know about Africa?
Why do you give money at church for the missionary work?
That's to help save people.
You mean save them from heathenism?
Yes.
Well, I'm afraid they need more salvation from the British and the French.
Well, guess from all the happy faces, everybody knows.
Ruth, you pregnant.
Lord have mercy, I sure hope it's a little old girl. Travis ought to have a sister.
Well, how far along are you?
2 months.
Did you mean to? I mean, did you plan it or was it an accident?
What do you know about planning or not planning?
She's 20 years old, Lena.
Did you plan it, Ruth?
Mind your own business.
It is my business. Where is he going to sleep, on the roof?
Mean that. Honest.
Gee, I don't feel like that at all. I think it is wonderful.
Wonderful.
Yes, really. What on earth is going on out there? Travis, what are you doing out there? They're chasing a rat.
Tell that youngster to get himself up here at once.
Travis, you come upstairs at once.
Doctor, say everything gonna be all right?
Yes, she says everything's gonna be fine.
She? What doctor did you go to?
Mama, you should have seen that rat. Big as a cat, honest. Golly, that rat was really cutting. Then Bubba got him with his heel. And the janitor, Mr. Barnett, got him with a stick. And they got him all locked in the corner. Bam, bam, bam. That rat was still jumping all around him. There's rat blood all over the street.
You hush up now. And stop talking all that terrible stuff.
You go on back outside now and play. But not with any rats.
Honey, what's the matter? You sick or something?
With her mom?
Oh, she'll be all right. Women get right depressed sometime when they get her way. You just relax now. That's right. Don't you think about nothing at all. Nothing at all.
All right, Mom.
Oh, come on, baby. You just lie down and rest a while. And then you have some nice hot food.
Oh, my God, that must be Arthur Guy.
It's all right.
Hello, Alayo.
Hello. Come in. Please excuse everything. My mother was very upset about my letting anyone come here with a place like this.
You look disturbed. Is something wrong?
Yes. We've all got acute ghetto-itis. So, sit down. Oh, no, wait! So, how was Canada?
Canadian.
Ostergaard, I'm very glad you're back.
Are you really?
Yes, very.
Why? You were quite glad when I went away. What happened?
You went away.
Aha.
Before, you wanted to be so serious before there was time.
How much time must there be before one knows what one feels?
What'd you bring me?
Open it.
Oh, Arthur Guy. Oh, you got them for me. How beautiful. And the records, too.
Wait. I shall have to teach you how to drape it properly. Let's see. Wait. Ah, Peggy Deo Bamushe. You wear it well, very well. Mutilated hair and all.
My hair? What's wrong with my hair?
Were you born with it like that?
No, of course not.
How bad?
You know perfectly well how. It's not as crinkly as yours, that's how.
And it is ugly to you that way.
Oh, no, not ugly. But it's so hard to manage when it's, well, wrong.
And so to accommodate that, you mutilate it every week.
It's not mutilation.
Oh, please. I'm only teasing you. Because you are so very serious about these things. Do you remember the first time we met at school? You came up to me and you said, and I thought you were the most serious little thing I had ever seen. You said that, Mr. Assegai, I want very much to talk with you about Africa. You see, Mr. Assegai, I'm looking for my identity.
Yes.
Well, it is true that this is not so much a profile of a Hollywood queen as perhaps a queen of the Nile. But what does it matter? Assimilationism is so popular in your country.
I am not an assimilationist.
Such a serious one. So, you like the robes? You must take excellent care of them. They are for my sister's personal wardrobe.
You sent all the way home for me?
For you, I would do much more. Well, that is what I came for. I must go.
Will you call me Monday?
Yes, we have a great deal to talk about, you and I. I mean about identity and time and all that.
Time?
Yes, about how much time one needs to know what one feels.
You see, you never understood that there is more than one kind of feeling which can exist between a man and a woman. Or at least there should be.
No, between a man and a woman, there need be only one kind of feeling. I have that for you. Now even. Right this moment.
I know. And by itself it won't do. I can find that anywhere.
For a woman, it should be enough.
Oh, I know. Because that's what it says in all the novels that men write. But it isn't. Well, go ahead and laugh, but I'm not interested in becoming someone's little episode in America. Or one of them. Well, that's funny as hell, huh? No.
It's just that every American girl I have known has said that to me. White, black, in this, you're all the same. And that same speech, too.
Yuck, yuck, yuck.
It's how you can be sure that the world's most liberated women are not liberated at all. You all talk about it too much.
Oh, Mama, this is Mr. Assegai.
How do you do, Mrs. Younger? Please forgive me for coming at such an outrageous hour on a Saturday.
Oh, you're quite welcome. I just hope you understand that our house don't always look like this. You must come again. I'd love to hear all about your country. I think it's so sad the way our American Negroes don't know nothing about Africa except Tarzan and all that. And all that money they pour into these churches when they ought to be helping you people over there drive out them French and Englishmen done taking away your land.
Ah, yes, yes.
How many miles did you say it's from here to where you come from?
Many thousands.
Bet you don't have to take care of yourself being away from your mama so far.
I expect you better come round here from time to time and get yourself some home-cooked meals.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Well, I must go. Oh. I will call you on Monday, Alayo.
What's that he call you?
Oh, Alayo, I hope you don't mind. It is what you call a nickname, I think. It is a Yoruba word. See, I am a Yoruba.
I thought you said you...
No. Nigeria is my country. Yoruba is my tribal origin.
You didn't tell us what Alayo means. For all I know, you might be calling me little idiot or something.
Let me see. I really do not know just how to explain it. The sense of a thing can be so different when it changes languages.
You're evading.
No, really, it is difficult. Well, it means one for whom bread, no, food, is not enough. Is that all right?
Thank you.
Well, that's nice. You must come again, Mr.
Asagai.
Yes, do come again.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Lord, that's a pretty thing just went out of here.
Yeah.
I guess I see why we done commenced to be so interested in Africa around here.
Missionaries, my Aunt Jenny.
Oh, Mama!
Travis, baby, run over next door and ask for coffee. Please let me have a little kitchen cleanser. This here can is as empty as Jacob's kettle.
I just came in.
You do as you're told. Where you going?
To become a queen of the Nile. Where did Benny go?
As far as I could make out, to Egypt.
Where did you get up?
Ain't nothing wrong with me to be lying in no bed for.
What time is it getting to?
10:20. And the mailman's gonna ring that bell this morning just like he done every morning for the last 10 years.
Grandmama, she said to tell you she don't have much.
Lord. Some people I could name sure is tight-fisted.
Lena, maybe the woman's just short on cleanser.
Much baking powder she done borrowed from me all these years.
Get down them steps, boy.
You mean you're gonna come?
Oh, Miss Lena.
Oh, I don't know what we all getting so excited around here for. We knowed it was coming for months.
Well, that's a whole lot different from having it come and being able to hold it in your hand. Piece of paper for $10,000? Oh, come on, open it. Oh, Lord have mercy, I sure wish Walter Lee was here.
Open it, Grandmama. Now, y'all be quiet. It's just a check.
Open it.
Now, don't act silly. We ain't never been a people to act silly about no money.
We ain't never had none before.
Travis, is something the right amount of zeros?
Yes. $10,000. Golly, Grandmama, you rich.
$10,000. Your Ruth put it away somewhere. $10,000 they give you. $10,000.
What's the matter with Grandmama? Don't she want to be rich?
You're going out and playing that big time.
You've gone and got yourself upset.
Think if it wasn't for y'all, I'd just put that money away or give it to the church or something.
Now, what kind of talk is that? Mr. Younger would just be plain mad to hear you talking foolish like that.
Yes, he sure would. We got enough to do with that money, all right. Where'd you go today, girl?
To the doctor.
Now, Ruth, you know better than that. Old Dr. Jones is strange enough in his way, but ain't nothing about it make somebody slip and call him she like you done this morning.
Well, that's just what happened. My tongue slipped.
You went to see that woman, didn't you?
What woman you talking about?
That woman who...
Milkman come. Did he come? Look, old Will Harris put everything on paper. The lawyers just looked at it and everything is fine.
Son, I think you ought to talk to your wife. I'll go out and leave you all alone.
I'll talk to her later, Mama. Look, listen.
Son.
Please, will somebody listen to me today?
I don't allow no yelling in this house, Walter Lee, and you know it. And there ain't gonna be no investing in no liquor store.
But, Mama, you ain't even looked at it.
I don't aim to have to speak on that again.
You ain't looked at it, and you don't aim to have to speak on that again. You ain't even looked at it, and you decided. Well, you tell that to my boy tonight when you put him to sleep on the living room couch.
Where you going?
Out.
Where?
Just out of this house somewhere.
I'll come, too.
I don't want you to come.
I got something I want to talk to you about, Walter.
I'll forget it.
Me.
Sit down.
I'm a grown man, Mama.
Ain't nobody said you wasn't grown, but you're still in my house and my presence. And as long as you are, you'll talk to your wife, Sybil. Now sit down.
Oh, let him go and out and break himself. Just let me sit down.
You turned mine too, baby. That was my biggest mistake.
What is the matter with you?
Matter with me? Ain't nothing the matter with me.
Well, yes, there is. Something is eating you up like a crazy man. Something more than me not giving you this money. These past few years, I've been watching it happen to you. You get all nervous acting and kind of wild in the eyes, and I say, sit there now, I'm talking to you.
Mama, I don't need no nagging at me today.
Seem like you getting to the place where you're always tied up in some kind of knot about something. But if anybody asks you about it, you just yell at them and bust out of the house and go out and drink somewhere. Walter Lee, people can't live with that. Ruth is a good, patient girl in her way, but you're getting to be too much. Boy, don't make the mistake of driving that girl away from you.
Why? What'd she ever do for me?
She loves you.
Mama, I'm going out. I want to be by myself for a while.
I'm sorry about your liquor store, son, but it just wasn't the thing for us to do. That's what I wanted to tell you.
I'm going out, Mama.
It's dangerous, son.
What's dangerous?
When a man goes outside his home to look for peace.
And then why can't there never be no peace in this house, then?
You done found it in some other house?
No, there ain't no woman. Why do women always think there's a woman somewhere when a man gets restless? Oh. Mama. Mama, do you know what this money means to me? Do you know what this money could do for us? Mama. Mama, I want so many things.
Yes, son.
I want so many things that they're driving me kind of crazy. Mama, look at me.
I'm looking at you, son. You're a good-looking boy. You got a job, a nice wife, and a fine son.
A job? Mama, a job? I open and close doors all day long. I drive a man around in his limousine. I say, yes, sir, no, sir, very good, sir. Shall we take the drive, sir? Mama, that ain't no kind of job. That ain't nothing at all. Mama, I don't know if I can make you understand.
Understand what, baby?
Sometimes it's like I see the future stretched out in front of me. Just plain as day, the future, Mama. Hanging over there at the edge of my day, just waiting for me. A big, looming, blank space full of nothing. Just waiting for me. But it don't have to be that way. Mama, sometimes I'm driving that man downtown and I pass them cool, quiet-looking restaurants where them white boys are sitting back and talking about things, sitting there and turning deals worth millions of dollars. Sometimes I see guys who don't look much older than me.
Son, why you have to talk so much about money?
And because it's life, Mama.
Oh. So now money is life? Once upon a time, freedom was life. Now it's money.
Mama, no, it was always money. No, we just didn't know about it.
Something's changed. You something new, boy. In my time, we worried about not being lynched and getting to the North if we could. Or how to stay alive and still have a pinch of dignity, too. Now here come you and Benita talking about things we ain't never even thought about, hardly me and your daddy. You ain't satisfied or proud of nothing we done. I mean that you had a home. That we kept you out of trouble till you was grown. That you don't have to ride to work on the back of nobody's streetcar. You my children, but... how different we done become.
You don't understand, Mama. You just don't understand.
Son, did you know your wife is expecting another baby? That's what she wanted to talk to you about. This ain't for me to be telling, but you ought to know. I think Ruth is thinking about getting rid of that child.
No. No, Ruth wouldn't do that.
When the world gets ugly enough, a woman will do anything for her family, the part that's already living.
You don't know Ruth, Mama, if you think she'd do that.
Yes, I would too, Walter. Gave her a $5 down payment.
Well? Well, son, I'm waiting to hear you say something. I'm waiting to hear how you be your father's son, be the man he was. Your wife says she gonna destroy your child. And I'm waiting to hear you talk like him. And say, we a family who give children life, not who destroys them. I'm waiting to see you stand up and look like your daddy and say, we done give up one baby to poverty and that we ain't gonna give up nary another one. I'm waiting. If you're a son of mine, tell her. are a disgrace to your father's memory. Somebody get me my hat.
A Raisin in the Sun will continue after this brief intermission. The presentation of American Playhouse is made possible by the nation's public television stations, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the National Endowment for the Arts, and by the Chubb Group of Insurance Companies, for over 100 years providing business and personal insurance worldwide through independent agents and brokers. Additional funding for A Raisin in the Sun was provided by the Ambassador International Cultural Foundation. This is PBS, the Public Broadcasting Service. We hope you're enjoying tonight's season premiere presentation on American Playhouse, and we'd like to take a moment to invite you to join us for more outstanding offerings during this 1989 American Playhouse season. Coming March 15th, for the first time on television, the hit motion picture Stand and Deliver, starring Lou Diamond Phillips, and David and Meredith Baxter Burney star in Mark Twain's Diaries of Adam and Eve on April 26th. Just a couple of American Playhouse presentations you won't want to miss here on TV 25. American Playhouse now returns with Act Two of Lorraine Hansberry's A Raisin in the Sun.
Looking at what a well-dressed Nigerian woman wears. Isn't it beautiful? Oh, enough of this assimilation.
An Ethiopia, stretch forth the arms again.
Yes, and Africa sure is claiming her own tonight.
Shut up. Damn drum. Drums move me. My heart of hearts, I'm much warrior.
In your heart of hearts, you're much warrior.
Be in YOLO. Do you hear the water rushing against the shores of our coastline?
Hey,
do you hear the screeching of the cocks in the yonder hills beyond where the chief meet in council for the coming of the mighty war? Do you hear the beating of the wings of the birds flying low over the mountains in the low places of our land? Do you hear the singing of the women, singing the war songs of our fathers to the babies in the great houses, singing the sweet war songs? Oh, do you hear, my black brother?
We hear you, Flaming Spear!
In telling us to prepare for the greatness of the time. Oh, black brother!
Black brother, hell!
Benita, you got company, girl. Oh, Lord, come on now. What is the matter with you? Walter, the young man, get down off the table now. He's had a little to drink. I don't know what her excuse is.
Look, honey, we're going to the theater. We're not going to be in it. So go change, huh? What in the name of...
Girl, you done lost your natural mind. Look at your head.
What have you done to your head? I mean, your hair.
Nothing except cut it off.
You expect this boy to go out with you with your hair looking nappy like that?
Well, that's up to George. If he's ashamed of his heritage.
Oh, don't be so proud of yourself, Benny, just because you look eccentric.
How can something that's natural be eccentric?
That's what being eccentric means, being natural. Get dressed.
I don't like that, George.
Why must you and your brother make an argument out of everything people say?
Because I hate assimilationist Negroes.
Will somebody please tell me what assimilar whoever means?
Oh, it's just a college girl's way of calling people Uncle Toms. But that's not what it means at all.
Well, what does it mean?
It means someone who is willing to give up his own culture and submerge himself completely in the dominant and, in this case, oppressive culture.
Dear, dear, dear. Here we go. A lecture on the African past and our great West African heritage. In 1 second, we will hear all about the great Ashanti empires, the great Songhai civilizations, and the great sculpture of Benin, and then some poetry in the Bantu. And the whole monologue will end with the word heritage. Let's face it, baby. Your heritage is nothing but a bunch of raggedy-ass spirituals and some grass huts.
Grass huts? See there? You are standing there in your splendid ignorance talking about people who are the first to smelt iron on the face of the earth. The Ashanti were performing surgical operations while the English were still tattooing themselves with blue dragons.
Have a seat, George. It's warm, ain't it? I mean, for September.
Well, just like they always say about Chicago weather, if it's too hot or cold, just wait a minute and it'll change. Everybody say it got to do with them bombs and things they keep setting off.
Would you like a nice cold beer?
No, thank you. I don't care for beer. Boy, I hope she hurries up.
Whew. What time is the show?
It's an 8:30 curtain. That's just Chicago, though. In New York, standard curtain time is 8:40.
You get to New York a lot?
Oh, a few times a year.
Oh, that's nice. I've never been to New York.
New York ain't got nothing Chicago, ain't. Except a bunch of hustling people all squeezed up together. Being Eastern.
Oh, you've been?
Plenty times.
Walter Lee, younger?
Plenty. Hey, what we got to drink in this house? Hey, why don't you offer this man some refreshment? Hey, he don't know how to entertain in this house, man.
Thank you. I don't care for anything.
Where's Mama?
She ain't come back yet.
Why do all you college boys wear them faggoty-looking white shoes?
Walter Lee!
White shoes, as cold as it is.
You have to excuse him.
Yeah, no, he don't. But you always excuse me, for I've excused myself if I needs to be excused. It looks funny as hell. Bad as them black knee socks Benita wears out here all the time.
It's the college style.
College style? Hell. She looks like she got burnt legs or something. How your old man making out? I understand you all gonna buy that big hotel on the drive. Shrewd move. Your man's all right, man. I mean, he knows how to operate. I mean, he thinks big. You know what I mean? But I think he's kind of running out of ideas now. Yeah, I'd like to talk to him. Listen, man, I got some plans that would turn this city upside down. I mean, I think like he does, big. Invest big, gamble big. Hell, lose big if you have to. You know, it's hard to find a man on this whole South Side who understands my kind of thinking. You dig? Yeah, you and me ought to sit down sometimes and talk. Man, I mean, I got me some ideas, man.
Yeah, sometimes we'll have to do that, Walter.
Yeah. Well, when you get the time, man. Well, you a busy little boy.
Walter Lee?
There ain't nothing in this world as busy as them colored college boys with their fraternity pins and their white shoes.
Walter Lee.
I see y'all all the time. Your books all tucked under your arms, going to your classes. And what for? What the hell are you learning over there? Filling your head up with the sociology and the psychology, but they're teaching you how to be a man? How to take over and run the world? They're teaching you how to run a rubber plantation or a steel mill? No. Just to talk proper and read books and wear them faggoty-looking white shoes.
You're all whacked up with bitterness, man.
And you? Ain't you bitter, man? Ain't you just about had it yet? Don't you see no stars gleaming that you can't reach out and grab? You happy? You content, oh, son of a bitch. You, ain't you happy? You got it made? Bitter. Man, I'm a volcano. Bitter. Here I am, a giant, surrounded by ants. Ants who can't even understand what a giant is talking about.
Walter, ain't you with nobody?
No, because ain't nobody with me. Not even my own mother.
Walter, that's a terrible thing to say.
Well, hey, you look great.
Ooh. What's the matter with your head?
I cut it off, brother.
Well, I'll be damned. So that's what they mean by the African bush.
Ha, ha. Let's go, George.
You know something? I like it. It's sharp. I mean, it really is.
Yes, I think so, too.
No, you don't. You leave yours alone. You might turn out to have a pin-shaped head or something.
See y'all later. Have a nice time.
Thanks. Good night. Good night, Prometheus.
Hey, who's Prometheus?
I don't know, honey. Don't worry about it.
You see there? They get to the point that they can't even insult you, man to man. They gotta go talk about something ain't nobody never heard of.
Well, how do you know it was an insult? Maybe Prometheus is a nice fella.
Prometheus? I bet there ain't even no such thing. I bet that simple-minded...
Walter!
Don't start!
Start what?
You're nagging. Where was I? Who I was with? How much money did I spend?
Well, honey, can't we just try to talk about it?
I've been out talking with people who understand me. People who care about the things that's on my mind.
I guess that means people like Willie Harris.
Yes, people like Willie Harris.
Then why don't y'all just hurry up and go into the banking business and stop talking about it?
Hey, you want to know why? Why? Because we're tied up in a race of people who can't do nothing but moan, pray, and have babies.
Honey, why can't you stop fighting me?
Hey, who's fighting you? Who even cares about you?
Well, I guess I might as well go on to bed. I don't know where we lost it, but we have.
I'm sorry about this new baby, Walter. I guess maybe I better go on and do what I started. I guess I just didn't realize how bad things was with us. I guess I just didn't realize. Want some hot milk?
Hot milk?
Yes, hot milk.
Why hot milk?
Because after all that liquor, you ought to have something hot.
I don't want no milk.
You want some coffee then?
No, I don't want no coffee. I don't want nothing hot to drink. Why are you always trying to give me something to eat?
What else can I give you, Walter Lee Younger?
Understanding as folks generally think they is. I mean, right between me and you, how it gets to the place where we're scared to talk softness to each other.
It a lot.
Hey, on account of you and me, you mean the way some things come down between us?
There ain't so much between us. Not when you come to me and you try to talk to me. Just try to be with me a little even.
Sometimes I don't even know how to try.
Walter.
Yes.
Honey, life don't have to be like this. I mean, sometimes people do things so that things are better. You remember how we used to talk when Travis was born about the way we was gonna live, kind of how. It's all starting to slip away from us.
Getting longer and longer. Ooh. How you feeling, Ruth?
Mama, where you been all day?
Where's Travis?
I let him go out. He ain't come back yet. Boys, he gonna get it.
Mama, where have you been? Mama.
Yes, son.
Where'd you go this afternoon?
I went downtown to tend to some business I had to tend to.
What kind of business?
Now, you know better than to question me like a child, brother.
Where were you, Mama?
money. Something crazy.
Mama. Mama, I nothing. Before you gonna get in there, you get on in that bedroom and get yourself ready.
But I got
how come you don't never let the child explain himself?
He's out of it now, Lena. Thousand times I have told you not to go off
well,
like that.
Well, at least let me tell him something. I want him to be the first one to hear it. Come here, baby. Come on. Travis, you know that money we got in the mail this morning?
Yes.
Well, what you think your grandma gone and done with that money?
I don't know, Grandmama.
She went and she bought you a house. You glad about that house? It's gonna be yours when you get to be a man.
Yes, and I always wanted to live in a house.
All right. Well, give me some sugar then. Now, when you say your prayers tonight, you thank God and your grandfather, 'cause was him give you the house in his way?
Now, you get on out of here and get ready for your beating.
Oh, Mama!
Come on, now. Get on in there, now. Oh, so you went and did it?
Yes, I did.
Praise God! Oh, Walter, honey. Baby, let me be glad. You be glad, too. Walter, a home. Where is it? How big is it? How much is it going to cost?
Well,
when we move it?
First of the month.
Praise God!
It's a nice house, too. 3 bedrooms.
Oh,
nice big one for you and Walter. Me and Benita still have to share ours, but Travis will have one of his own. And I figure if the new baby is a boy, we'll get him one of them double-decker outfits. And there is a yard with a little old patch of dirt where I could maybe get to grow me a few flowers. And a nice big basement.
Walter, honey, be glad.
Of course now, I don't want to make it sound fancier than it is. It's just a plain little old house, but it's built good and solid. And it will be ours. Walter Lee, it makes a difference in a man when he can walk on floors that belong to him.
Where is it?
Well, it's out there in Clybourne Park.
Where?
406 Clybourne Street, Clybourne Park.
Clybourne Park? Mama, there ain't no colored people living in Clybourne Park.
Well, there's gonna be some now.
So that's the peace and comfort you went out and bought for us today.
Son, I just tried to find the nicest place for the least amount of money for my family.
Well, 'cause I ain't one never been afraid of no crackers, mind you, but Mama, wasn't there no other houses nowhere?
Them houses they put up for coloreds in them areas way out all seem to cost twice as much as other houses. I did the best I could.
Well. Ooh, well. All I can say is, if this is my time in life, my time to say goodbye to these goddamn cracking walls and these marching roaches and that cramped little closet that ain't now never was no kitchen, then I say it loud and good. Hallelujah! Goodbye, misery! I don't never want to see your ugly face again. Oh, Lena.
Yes, baby?
Is there a whole lot of sunlight?
Yes, child. There's a whole lot of sunlight.
Well,
I guess I better go see about Travis. Lord, I sure don't feel like whipping nobody today.
Son, you understand what I've done, don't you?
I just seen my family falling apart today, just falling to pieces right in front of my eyes. We couldn't have gone on like we was today. Talking about killing babies and wishing each other was dead. When it gets like that in life, you just got to do something different. Push on out and do something bigger. I wish you'll say something, son. Wish you'll say how deep inside you think I done the right thing.
What you need me to say you done right for? You the head of this family? You run our lives like you want to. Give us your money and you did what you wanted with it. So what you need me to say, it was all right for. So you butchered up a dream of mine. You were always talking about your children's dreams.
Okay, whatever you say.
George, please.
Look, we've had a nice evening. Let's not spoil it, huh?
I'm trying to talk to you.
We always talk.
Yes, and I love to talk.
I know it, and I don't mind it sometimes. Look, I want you to cut it out, see? This moody stuff, I don't like it. You are a nice-looking girl, all over. That's all you need, honey. Forget the atmosphere. Guys aren't going to go for the atmosphere. They're going to go for what they see. Be glad for that. Benita, please. Drop the Garbo routine. It doesn't go with you. As for myself, I would like a nice, simple, sophisticated girl. Not a poet. Okay?
George, why are you angry?
Because this is stupid. Look, I don't go out with you to discuss the nature of quiet desperation or to hear all your thoughts. Because the world will go on thinking what it thinks regardless.
Then why read books? Why go to school?
It's simple. You read books to learn facts, to get grades, to pass the course, to get a degree. That's all. It has nothing to do with thoughts.
I see. Good night, George.
Hello, George. How are you feeling this evening?
Fine, fine. How are you?
Oh, a little tired. Your stairs kind of wear you out after a day's work. You all have a nice time tonight?
Yes, fine time. Fine time.
Well, good night, George. Hello, honey. What you sitting like that for?
I'm just sitting.
Well, now that your company is gone, why don't you make up Travis's bed for him? Didn't you have a nice time tonight?
No.
No? What's the matter?
Mama?
Yes, baby.
George is a fool. Honest.
Is he, baby?
Yes.
You sure?
Yes.
I guess you better not be wasting your time with no fool.
Mama?
Yes, honey.
Thank you.
For what?
For understanding me this time.
I just thought I'd sort out a few things. Is brother here?
Yes.
Is he?
Yes.
Oh, hello there, Miss Johnson.
Hello there yourself. How are you this evening, Ruth?
Fine, Miss Johnson. How are you?
I'm fine. Ain't poking out none yet? Oh, ain't we getting ready, though? Yes, sir, will you look at that? I'm telling you. The youngers are finally getting ready to move on up a little higher, bless God.
Bless God.
Oh, he's good, ain't he?
Oh, yes, he's good.
I mean, he works in mysterious ways, but he works, don't he?
Yes, he does.
I sure am happy for you all, this here child. Look like she's about to pop open with happiness, don't she? Oh, where's all the rest of the family?
Benny's lying. They're gone to bed.
Oh, ain't no sickness yet, I hope.
No, she's just a little tired. She was out this evening.
Oh, ain't that lovely. She's still going out with the little Murchison boy?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, ain't that lovely.
Bruce, why don't you get Mrs. Johnson a piece of sweet potato pie and some milk?
Oh, honey, I ain't hardly got a minute. I just thought I would drop by to see if there's anything I could do. I guess y'all seen the news that's all over that colored paper this week.
No, I didn't get mine yet this week.
You mean you ain't heard about them colored people that bombed out of that place out there? Ain't it somehow bad these white folks are getting here in Chicago? No, it's getting so you'd think he was down in Mississippi. But I think it's wonderful how our people just pushes on out. You know, I see some of these Negroes always talking about they don't want to go nowhere they ain't wanted. But not me. Wilhelmina Othello Johnson goes anywhere, anytime she feels like it. Yes, I do. Why, if we left it up to some of these crackers, these poor niggas wouldn't have nothing. I always forget that you don't allow that word in your mouth.
No, I don't allow it.
Me neither.
Don't you want another piece of pie?
No, honey. I got to be getting on home and have my midnight coffee. I hear some people say don't let them sleep. But I finds I can't close my eyes unless I has my last cup of coffee. My good night coffee, I call it.
Ruth, why don't you get Miss Johnson her good night coffee?
Where's brother tonight?
He's lying down.
He sure do get his duty rest, don't he? Good-looking man. Sure is a good-looking man. I guess that's how come we start having so many babies around here. One thing about brother, he sure know how to have a good time. So ambitious. I bet it was his idea y'all move out there to Clybourne Park. Lord, I bet this time next month, y'all's names will have been in the paper aplenty. Negroes invade Clybourne Park. Bombed.
We ain't exactly moving out there to get bombed.
Oh, honey, don't you know I'll be praying to God every day that nothing like that happens. But you have to take life as it is. Now, these Chicago peckerwoods are some bad peckerwoods.
We done thought about all that, Miss Johnson.
Mama. Hello there, Benny.
Hello, Mrs. Johnson.
How is school?
Fine, thank you.
Huh. Getting so she don't want to say nothing to nobody.
The child was on her way to the bathroom.
I know. Sometimes she acts like she ain't got time to pass the time of nobody what ain't in the college. I ain't criticizing none. It's just that, well, you know how some of our young folk act when they get a little education. Of course, I understand her being proud and everything. Being she's the only one in the family to make something of herself. I just know being a chauffeur ain't never satisfied brother none. Cause he ought not be like that, though, cause ain't nothing wrong with being a chauffeur.
There's plenty wrong with it.
What?
Plenty. My husband always said being any kind of servant ain't no fit thing for any man to have to be. He always said a man's hands was made to make things or turn the earth with, not to drive nobody's car for him or carry their slop jars. And my boy is just like him. He was not meant to wait on nobody.
You youngers is too much for me. You know, you all sure are some proud acting colored folks. Yes, well, like I always think, like what Booker T. Washington said that time. Education has spoiled many a good plow hand.
Did old Booker T. say that?
He sure did.
Well, it sounds just like him.
A fool.
Why, he was one of our great men.
Who said so?
You know, Lena, me and you ain't never agreed on some things. Well, I guess I'll be going.
Good night.
Good night. You can keep that paper. Good night, y'all.
Good night, Miss Johnson.
Ignorance was gold.
Shh. It ain't nice to talk about people behind their back.
You do.
I'm old and corrupted.
You were rude to Miss Johnson, Vanitha, and I don't like that at all.
Mama, if there are two things we as a people have got to overcome, one is the Ku Klux Klan, and the other is Wilhelmina Oldfella Johnson.
Smart Alec.
I'll get it. Hello? Just a minute. Walter, it's Mrs. Arnold. Hello? Yes, this is his wife speaking. He's lying down now. Yes. Well, he'll be in tomorrow. He's been very sick. Yes. I know we should have called, but we were so sure he'd be able to come in today. Yes. Yes, I'm very sorry. Yes. Thank you very much. That was Mrs. Arnold.
Was it?
She said if you don't come in tomorrow that they are getting a new man.
That's crying sick.
She said Mr. Arnold has had to take a cab for 3 days. Walter, you ain't been to work in 3 days? Where you been, Walter Lee Younger? You gonna lose your job.
That's right.
Oh, Walton, with your mother working like a dog every day?
Oh, that's sad. Everything is so sad.
Where you been these 3 days, son?
Mama, you don't know all the things a man with got leisure can find to do in this city. What's this? Friday night. For Wednesday, I bought Willie Hare's car and I went for a drive. It's me and myself. And I just drove and drove way out, way past South Chicago. And I parked the car. And I sat and looked at the steel mills all day long. I just sat there and looked at them big black chimneys for hours. And then I drove back and I went to the Green Hat. And Thursday I borrowed the car again. And I pointed it the other way. And I drove for hours way, way up to Wisconsin and looked at the farms. I just drove and looked at the farms. And then I drove back and I went to the Green Hat. And today I didn't get the car. Today I just walked all around the South Side. And I looked at the Negroes. And they looked at me. Then finally, I sat down on the curve of 39th and South Parkway. And I just sat there and watched the Negroes go by. And then I went to the Green Hat. Y'all sad? Y'all depressed? And you know where I'm going now.
Big Walter, is this the harvest of our days?
Mama, you know what I like about the Green Hat? They got this little captain there who blows the sax. I mean, he talks to me. He ain't but about 5 feet. He got his eyes closed all the time. And he's all music.
Walter Lee.
And there's another fella on the piano. They got a sound. I mean, they can work on some music. I mean, they got the best little combo in the world at the Green Hat. You just sit there, drink, and listen to them three men play. He realized it ain't nothing worth a damn but being there.
I've helped do it to you, haven't I? Oh, Walter, I've been wrong.
No, you ain't never been wrong about nothing, Mama.
Listen to me now, son. I said I've been wrong. Well, I've been doing to you what the rest of the world's been doing to you. Walter, what you ain't never understood is that I ain't got nothing, don't own nothing, never really wanted nothing that wasn't for you. There ain't nothing as precious to me. There ain't nothing worth holding on to, money, dreams, nothing else, if it means it's going to destroy my boy. I paid that man $3,500 down on the house. That leaves $6,500. Monday morning, I want you to take this money and put $3,000 into a saving account for Benita's medical school, and the rest of it, you put into a checking account with your name on it. And from now on, any penny that comes out of it or goes into it is for you to look after. For you to decide. It ain't much, but It's all I got in the world. And I'm putting it into your hands. And I'm telling you to be the head of this family like you're supposed to be. You like I ain't never stopped loving you.
Children, oh, you know what I'm gonna do soon as I get in that house?
Oh, what?
I'm gonna run me a tub of water up to here. Ooh, and I'm gonna get in it, and I'm gonna sit and sit and sit in that hot water, and the first person that knocks
gets shot at sunrise.
You said it, sister. Honey, They ain't gonna be reading that from no airplane.
Well, I guess I always think things have more emphasis if they're big somehow.
You and your brother seem to have that as a philosophy of life. Oh, Lord, that man done changed so around here. You know what we did last night, me and Walter?
What?
We went to the movies.
Stop!
We went to the movies. You know the last time me and Walter Lee went to the movies together?
No.
Me neither. That's how long it been. But we went last night. Picture wasn't much good, but that didn't matter. We went and we held hands.
Oh, Lord!
We held hands, and you know what? When we come out the show, it was late and dark, and all the stores and things was all closed up, and it was kind of chilly. Wasn't many people on the street. Ooh. And we were still holding hands, me and Walter.
Oh, you are killing me.
Look at that. All right.
You know, when these professional new Negroes have a convention, that is going to be the chairman of the committee on unending agitation. race, girl, I do believe you're the first person in the history of the entire human race to successfully brainwash your own self. Damn, even the NAACP takes a holiday sometimes. I could just see that chick someday looking down at some poor cat on the operating table, and just before she slices him, she'll say, "Now, what did you say your views on civil rights were?"
Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me.
How do you do, miss? I'm looking for Mrs. Lena Younger.
Yes, that's my mother. Excuse me. Mother! Hmm? There's at the door.
Come in, please.
Thank you.
My mother isn't here just now. Is it business?
Yes. Well, of a sort.
Have a seat.
Oh, thank you.
I'm Mrs. Younger's son. I look after most of her business matters.
My name is Carl Lindner.
Walter Younger.
How do you do?
My wife and my sister. What can we do for you, Mr. Lindner?
Well, I'm a representative of the Clyburn Park Improvement Association, and...
Oh, why don't you put your things on the couch?
Oh yes. Mm. Thank you. As I was saying, I'm from the Clyburn Park Improvement Association, and we had it brought to our attention at the last meeting that you people, or at least your mother, has bought a piece of residential property at 406 Clyburn Street.
That's right. I care for something to drink. Ruth, get Mr. Lindner a beer.
Oh, no, really. I mean, thank you very much, but no thank you.
Some coffee?
Thank you, nothing at all. Well, I don't know how much you folks know about our organization. Well, it's one of these community organizations set up to look after, things like block upkeep and special projects. And we also have what we call our New Neighbors Orientation Committee.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and what do they do?
Well, it's what you might call a sort of welcoming committee, I guess. We... Well, I'm the chairman. Go around and see the new people who move into the neighborhood and sort of give them the lowdown on the way we do things out in Clyburn Park.
Uh-huh.
And we also have the category of what the association calls special community problems.
Yes, and what are some of those?
Girl, let the man talk.
Well, thank you. I would sort of like to explain this thing in my own way. I want to explain it to you in a certain way.
Go ahead.
Yes. Well, I'm going to try to get right to the point. I'm sure we'd all appreciate that in the long run.
Yes.
Be still.
To get right to the point.
Would you like another chair? You don't look comfortable.
No, thank you very much. Please. Well, to get right to the point, I'm sure that you people must be aware of some of the incidents that have happened in various parts of the city when colored people move into certain areas. Well, because we have what I think is going to be a unique type of organization in American community life. I mean, not only do we deplore that kind of thing, but we're trying to do something about it. We feel that most of the trouble in this world, when you come right down to it, most of the trouble exists because people just don't sit down and talk to each other.
You can say that again, mister.
That we don't try hard enough in this world to understand the other fella's problem, the other guy's point of view.
Now, that's right.
Well, yes, that's the way we feel out in Clyburn Park. And that's why I was elected to come here this afternoon and see if we can't find some way to work this thing out. Anybody can see that you're a nice family of folks. Hardworking and honest, I'm sure. And, well, today everybody knows what it means to be an outsider. And of course, there's always somebody who's out to take advantage of people who don't understand.
What do you mean?
Well, you see, our community is made up of people who've worked hard as a dickens for years to build up that little community. I mean, we're not rich and fancy people. We're just hardworking, honest people who don't really have much but those little homes and a dream of the kind of community we want to raise our children in. Well, I don't say that we're perfect, and there is a lot wrong in some of the things that we want. But you've got to admit that man, right or wrong, has the right to want to have the neighborhood he lives in a certain kind of way. And at the moment, the overwhelming majority of our people out there feel that people get along better, take more of a common interest in the life of the community when they share a common background. Well, I want you to believe me when I tell you race prejudice simply doesn't enter into it. It's a matter of the people of Clyburn Park believing, now rightly or wrongly, as I say, that for the happiness of all concerned, that our Negro families are happier when they live in their own communities.
This, friends, is the welcoming committee.
Is this what you came marching all the way over here to tell us?
Now, we've been having a fine conversation. I hope you'll hear me all the way through.
Go ahead, ma'am.
Well, you see, in the face of all the things I've said, we're prepared to make your family a very generous offer.
30 pieces and not a coin less.
Yeah.
Our association is prepared, through the collective efforts of our people, to buy the house from you at a financial gain to your family.
Lord have mercy, ain't this the living God?
You through?
Man, I want to give you the exact terms of the financial...
We don't want to hear no exact terms and no arrangement. I want to know if you got any more to tell about getting together.
Well, I don't suppose you feel like...
No, never mind how I feel. You got any more to say about how people ought to sit down and talk to each other? Get out of my house, man.
I don't understand why you people are reacting this way. Now, what do you think you're going to gain by moving into a neighborhood where you aren't wanted and where some... Well, people can get awful worked up when they feel their whole way of life and everything they ever worked for is threatened.
Get out.
I'm sorry it went like this.
Get out!
You just can't force people to change their hearts, son.
Before God, my children got all the energy of the dead. What time the moving people do here?
4 o'clock. You had a caller, Mama.
Sure enough.
The welcoming committee.
Who?
The welcoming committee. They said they sure gonna be glad to see you when you get there.
Yeah, they said they can't hardly wait to see your face.
Well, you all.
Ain't nothing the matter with us. We're just telling you about the gentleman who came to see you from the
Clybourne Park Improvement Association.
What did he want?
To welcome you, honey.
He said if there's one thing that they don't have that they just dying to have out there, and that's a fine family, fine colored people.
Yeah, he left his car in case.
Father, give us strength. Did he threaten us?
Oh, Mama, they don't do it like that anymore. He talked brotherhood. He said everybody ought to learn how to sit down and hate each other with good Christian fellowship.
Lord, protect us.
You should hear all the money them folks raised to buy the house back.
Oh, we paid and then some.
Well, what they think we're going to do, eat them?
No, honey, marry them.
Oh, Lord, Lord.
Well, that's the way the crackers crumble.
Joke?
Oh, come on, I was crying. Mama, what are you doing?
I'm fixing up my plant so it don't get hurt not on the way.
Mama, you taking that to the new house? Mm-hmm. That raggedy-looking old thing.
It expresses me.
Oh! There, Miss Faye. You're
gonna make me mess up my seat here.
Oh, Mama, you know what it means to climb up in the chariot.
Go away from me now.
What's that old song say, Mama?
Walter, now.
I got wings, you got wings, all got children got wings.
Boy, you better get out of my face and do some work.
When we get to heaven, gonna put on the wings, gonna fly all over God's heaven.
Everybody talking about heaven ain't going there.
I don't know. You think we ought to give her this? Seems to me she ain't been very cooperative around here.
What is it?
What do you think? Should we give it to her?
Oh, she was pretty good today.
Oh, pretty good, you.
Open it, Mama.
Yeah, open it, Mama, for you. Read the note. Ruth wrote the note.
Oh. To our own Mrs. Miniver, love from brother Ruth and Benita. That's lovely. Thank you, son.
Daddy, can I give him mine now?
All right, son.
Now I don't have to use my knives and forks no more.
Travis didn't want to go in with the rest of us. He got his own. We don't know what it is.
Lord have mercy, baby. You done gone and brought your grandmother.
Yeah, open it.
Travis, honey, what is that?
It's a gardening hat. Like the ladies always have on in the magazines when they walk in their garden.
Travis, we were trying to make Mama Mrs. Miniver, not Scarlett O'Hara.
What's the matter with you all? This here is a beautiful hat. I always wanted me one just like it.
Mama!
I'm sorry, Mama, but you look like you're ready to go out and chop some cotton, sure enough.
Bless your heart, baby. This is the loveliest hat I ever owned.
What is that? Maybe they get with you.
Well, I don't know what we all standing around here for. We ain't finished packing yet. Benita, you ain't packed one book.
Well, it couldn't be the movers. It's not hardly too good yet.
Wait. I'll give it.
You expecting company, son?
Yeah.
Well, let them in, son. Let them in. We need more string.
Travis, run to the hardware and get me some string cord.
Why don't you answer the door, man?
Because sometimes it's hard to let the future begin. I got wings, you got wings, all the children got wings. When I get to you? Hey, where Willie?
He ain't with me.
Oh. Come on in, man. Hey, you know my way.
Yes, how you, Miss Ruth?
Hello, Bobo.
Right on time today, man. Right on time. Way to go. Hey, come on, have a seat. Let me hear it. Let me hear it. Have a seat.
Could I please get a drink of water before I tell you about it, Walter Lee?
Ain't nothing wrong, is it?
Let me tell you.
Ain't nothing let go wrong.
Let me tell you, Walter Lee. I got to tell you how it was. I mean, first, I got to tell you how it was all the way. I mean, about the money I put in, Walter Lee.
What about the money you put in?
Well, it wasn't much as we told you, me and Willie. I'm sorry, Walter. I got a bad feeling about it. I got a real bad feeling about it.
What you telling me all this for? Tell me what happened in Springfield.
Springfield.
What was supposed to happen in Springfield?
This deal that me and Walter went into with Willie. Me and Willie was going to go down to Springfield and spread some money around so we wouldn't have to wait so long for the liquor license. I mean, everybody said that's the way you had to do. You understand, Miss Ruth?
Hey, man, what happened down there?
Well, I'm trying to tell you.
But damn it, man, tell me what happened down there.
Man, I didn't go to no Springfield yesterday.
Why not?
Because I didn't have no reasons to.
And what you talking about?
I'm talking about the fact that when I got to the train station yesterday morning, 8 o'clock like we planned, man, Willie didn't ever show up.
Why? Where was he? Where is he?
That's what I'm trying to tell you, man. I don't know.
I waited 6 hours. I called his house and I waited 6 hours. I waited in that train station 6 hours. Man, Willie is gone. What do you mean Willie's gone? Gone where? You mean he went by himself? Yeah. Yeah, sure. Maybe he didn't want too many people you know in the business down there. Hey, you know Willie got his ways. Maybe you were late yesterday and he went on there by himself. Maybe Z's calling you at home right now. Maybe he's sick. He's somewhere. He's gotta be somewhere. And we gotta find him, man. We gotta go out and find him.
What's the matter, Mr. Walter?
When he can't take off with your money, he don't leave you no roadmaps. I'm no Willie. No. Willie, don't do it, man. Please don't do it. Not to with that money, man. No. Oh, God, don't let it be. Don't let it be true. I can't. Man, I trusted you. I put my life in your hands. Man, that money was made from my father's flesh.
I'm sorry, Walter. I had my life staked on this deal.
Son. Son, is it gone? Son, I gave you $6,500. Is it gone? All of it? Benita's money, too?
Mama, I ain't going to no bank.
You mean your sister's school money, Walter? You use that too, Walter?
All of it is all gone.
I've seen him night after night come in here and look at this mug and look at me. Dread showing in his eyes. The veins moving in his head. I seen him grow thin and old before he was 40. Working and working and
working like somebody's old horse. Killing himself. And you... you give it all away in one day, Walter Lee.
Walter! Oh, Mama! Mama!
Oh, God. Look down here and show me the strength. Father! Strength! Strength!
A Raisin in the Sun will continue after this brief intermission. The presentation of American Playhouse is made possible by the nation's public television stations, the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the National Endowment for the Arts, and by the Chubb Group of Insurance Companies, for over 100 years providing business and personal insurance worldwide through independent agents and brokers. Additional funding for A Raisin in the Sun was provided by the Ambassador International Cultural Foundation. This is PBS, the Public Broadcasting Service. During tonight's brief intermission on the American Playhouse season premiere of A Raisin in the Sun, we'd like to extend you an invitation to be with us throughout the season for excellent programs like The Meeting, which deals with the civil rights movement and airs June 14th. And next week, the stylish romantic comedy, Ask Me Again. Just two of the many critically acclaimed offerings in the 1989 season on American Playhouse here on TV 25. American Playhouse now returns with Act Three of Lorraine Hansberry's A Raisin in the Sun.
I came over. I thought I might help with the packing. I like the look of packing crates. A household in preparation for a journey. It depresses some people, but for me, it is another feeling. Something full of the flow of life. Do you understand? Movement, progress. It makes me think of Africa.
Africa.
What kind of mood is this? Have I told you how deeply you move me?
He gave away the money, Osagai.
Who gave away what money?
The insurance money. My brother gave it away.
Gave it away?
Oh, he made an investment with a man even Travis wouldn't have trusted with his most worn-out marbles.
And it's gone.
Gone.
I'm very sorry. And you now?
Me, I have nothing. Me. When I was very small, we used to take our sleds out in the wintertime. And the only hills we had were the ice-covered stone steps of some houses down the street. And we used to fill them in with snow and make them smooth and slide down them all day. And it was very dangerous, you know, far too steep. And sure enough, One day a kid named Rufus came down too fast and hit the sidewalk. And we saw his face just split open right there in front of us. And I remember standing there looking at his bloody open face thinking, well, that was the end of Rufus. But then the ambulance came. And they took him to the hospital, and they fixed the broken bones, and they sewed it all up. And the next time I saw Rufus, he had just a little line going down the middle of his face. I never got over that.
What?
That was what one human being could do for another. Fix him up. Sew up the problem, make him all right again. That was the most marvelous thing in the world, and I wanted to do that. I always thought it was the one concrete thing in the world that a human being could do. Fix up the sick, you know, and make them whole again. This was truly being God.
You wanted to be God.
I wanted to cure. It used to be so important to me. I wanted to cure. I used to care, I mean, about people and how their bodies hurt.
And you have stopped caring?
Yes, I think so.
Why?
Because it doesn't seem deep enough, close enough to what ails mankind. It was a child's way of seeing things, or an idealist.
Children see things very well sometimes. An idealist even better.
I know that's what you think, because you are still where I left off. You still care. You, with all your talk and dreams about Africa, you still think that you can patch up the world. Cure the great sore of colonialism with the penicillin of independence.
Yes?
Independence, and then what? What about all the crooks and thieves and just plain idiots who will come into power to steal and plunder the same as before? Only now they will be black and do it in the name of the new independence. What about them?
That will be the problem for another time. First, we must get there.
And where does it end?
End? Whoever spoke of an end to life, to living?
And into misery, to stupidity! Don't you see there isn't any real progress, Alpha Guy? There's only one large circle that we march in around and around, each of us, with our own little picture in front of us, our own little mirage that we think is the future.
That is the mistake.
What?
What you just said about the circle. It isn't a circle. It is simply a long line as in geometry, you know, one that curves into infinity. And because we cannot see the end, we also cannot see how it changes. And it is very odd for those who see the changes, who dream, who won't give up, are called idealists. And those who see only the circle, they call each other the realists.
Oh, Sagar, well, I was sleeping in that bed in there. People went out and took the future right out of my hands, and nobody asked me. They just went out and changed my life.
Was it your money?
What?
Was it your money he gave away?
It belonged to all of us.
But did you earn it? Would you have had it at all if your father had not died?
No.
Then isn't there something wrong in a house, in a world where all dreams, good or bad, must depend on the death of a man? I never thought to see you like this, Alayo. Look, your brother made a mistake, and you are grateful to him so that now you can give up the ailing human race on account of it. You talk about what good is struggle. What good is anything? Where are we all going? And why are we bothering?
And you cannot answer it!
I leave the answer! In my village at home, it is the exceptional man who can even read a newspaper, or whoever sees a book at all, I will go home, and much of what I will have to say will seem strange to the people in my village. But I will teach and work, and things will happen slowly and swiftly. At times, it will seem that nothing changes at all. And then again, the sudden dramatic events which make history leap into the future. Then quiet again. Retrogression even, guns, murder, revolution. And I even will have moments when I wonder if the quiet was not better than all that death and hatred. But I will look about my village at the illiteracy, disease, and ignorance. And I will not wander long. And perhaps, I will be a great man. I mean, perhaps, I will hold on to the substance of truth and perhaps for it, I will be butchered in my bed some night by the servants of empire.
The martyr!
Or perhaps I shall live to be a very old man, respected and esteemed in my new nation. And perhaps I shall hold office. And this is what I am trying to tell you, Alayo. Perhaps the things I believe now for my country will be wrong and outmoded. And I will not understand and do terrible things to have things my way or merely to keep my power. But don't you see? There will be young men and women. Not British soldiers then, but my own black countrymen to step out of the shadows some evening and slit my then useless throat. And don't you see? They have always been there that they always will be. And that such a thing as my own death will be an advance. But they who might kill me even actually replenish all that I was.
Oh, Cigar, I know all that.
Good. Then stop the moaning and groaning and tell me what you plan to do.
Do?
I have a bit of a suggestion.
What?
That when it is all over, that you come home with me.
Oh, Sagai, at this moment you decide to be romantic.
My dear young creature of the new world, I do not mean across the city. I mean across the ocean. Home. To Africa.
To Africa?
Yes. 300 years later, the African prince rose up out of the seas and swept the maiden back across the middle passage over which her ancestors had come.
To Nigeria?
Nigeria. Home. I'll show you our mountains and our stars. And give you cool drinks from gods and teach you the old songs and the ways of our people. And in time, we will pretend that you have only been away for a day. Say that you will come.
All mixed up.
Why?
Too many things. Too much has happened today. I don't know what I feel about anything. I'm just gonna sit down and think.
All right. I shall leave you. No. Don't get up. Just sit a while and think. Never be afraid to sit a while and think. How often I have looked at you and said, ah, so this is what the new world had finally wrought.
Just look at what the new world hath wrought. Just look. There he is. Monsieur le petit bourgeois noir himself, there he is. Symbol of a rising class, titan of the system. Did you dream of yachts on Lake Michigan, brother? Did you see yourself on that great day sitting down at the conference table, surrounded by all the mighty bald-headed men in America, all halting, waiting for your pronouncements on industry, waiting for you? Jam it on the board!
Who was that?
Your husband.
Where did he go?
How should I know? Maybe he had an appointment at U.S. Steel.
You didn't say nothing bad to him, did you?
Bad? Say anything bad to him? No. I told him he was a sweet boy and full of dreams, and everything is strictly peachy keen, as your fake kids say.
Well, ain't it a mess in here, though? I guess we all better stop moping around and get some work done, all the unpacking and everything we got to do. Well, now you better call the moving people and tell them not to come.
Tell them not to come?
Of course, baby. Ain't no need them coming all the way here and having to go back. They charges for that, too.
No, Lena.
Lord, ever since I was a little girl, I always remember people saying, Lena Eggleston, you aims too high all the time. You needs to slow down and see life a little more like it is. That's what they always say. Lena Eggleston is a high-minded thing. She'll get her just due one day.
Lena, we gotta go.
Me and Big Walter just didn't ever learn right.
Benny, tell her, please. Please tell her that we can still move. The notes ain't but $125 a month. We got four grown people in this house. We can work.
Just aim too high all the time.
Lena, I'll work 20 hours a day in all the kitchens in Chicago. I'll strap my baby on my back if I... And I'll scrub all the floors in America. I'll wash all the sheets in America if I have to. But we have got to move. We have got to get out of here.
I see things differently now. I've been thinking how we could fix this place up some. I seen a second-hand bureau over on Maxwell Street just the other day that'll fit right there. And we could put up them new curtains in the kitchen and some nice screens in your room round the baby's bassinet. Why, this place would be looking fine. Cheer us all up so we forget trouble ever come. Sometimes you just got to know when to give up some things and hold on to what you got. Where you been, son?
Made a call.
To who, son?
The man.
What man, baby?
The man, Mama. Don't you know who the man is?
Walter Lee?
The man. Like the guys in the street say, man. Captain, boss, Mr. Charlie. Old Captain, please, Mr. Bossman.
Linda!
That's right. That's good. Told him to come right over.
For what? What do you want to see him for?
We're going to do business with him.
What you talking about, son?
I'm talking about life, Mama. You all always telling me to see life like it is. Well, I laid there on my back today, and I figured it out. Life just like it is. Who gets and who don't gets. Mama, you know, it's all divided up. Life is, sure enough, between the takers and the tooken. And some of us always getting tooken. Hey, but people like Willie Harris, they don't ever get tooken. You know why the rest of us do? Because we all mixed up. We mixed up bad. We go around looking for the right and the wrong, and we worry about it and cry about it and stay up nights trying to figure out about the wrong and the right of things all the time. And all the time, them takers is out there operating and taking and taking. Willie Harris? Shoo! Willie Harris don't even count. He don't even count in the big scheme of things. But I'll say something for old Willie. He taught me something. To keep my eye on what does count in the world. Yeah, thanks, Willie.
What did you call that man for, Walter Lee?
I called him to come on over to the show. And we're going to put on a show for the man. Just what he wants to see. You see, Mama, the man came here today himself to tell us that them people out there where you want us to move, well, they're so upset, they're willing to pay us not to move. And Mama, oh, Mama, you would have been so proud of the way me and Ruth and Benny acted. We told him to get out. Lord have mercy, we told the man to get out. Oh, we was some proud folks this afternoon. We was full of that old time stuff.
Talking about taking them people's money to keep us from moving in that house.
I ain't talking about doing it, baby. I'm telling you, that's what's gonna happen.
Oh, God, where is the bottom? Where is the honest-to-God bottom so he cannot go any further?
Hey, where is the bottom? Where is the bottom? You and that boy that was here today, you all want everybody to carry a flag and a spear and to sing some marching songs, huh? You want to spend your life looking into things and trying to find out the wrong and the right thing part, huh? Hell, you know what's going to happen to that boy someday? He's going to find himself sitting in a dungeon locked up forever, and the takers is going to have the key. Forget it, baby. There ain't no causes. There ain't nothing but taking in this world, and he who takes the most is the smartest, and it don't make a damn bit of difference how.
Making something inside me cry, son. Some awful pain inside me.
Oh, don't cry, Mama. Understand. That man is going to walk in that door able to write a check for more money than we ever had. It's important to him, and I'm going to help him. I'm gonna put on a show!
Son, I come from five generations of people who were slaves and sharecroppers. But ain't nobody in my family never took no money from nobody. That was a way of telling us we wasn't fit to walk the earth. We ain't never been that poor. We ain't never been that dead inside.
We are dead now. All that talk about dreams and sunlight that goes on in this house, it's all dead now.
What's the matter with y'all? I didn't make this world. It was given to me this way. Hell yes, I want to have me some yacht someday. Yes, I want to hang some real pearls on my wife's neck. Ain't she supposed to have pearls? Somebody tell me. Tell me who is it decide which woman's supposed to wear pearls in this world. I tell you, I'm a man, and I think my wife should wear some pearls in this world.
Son, how you going to feel on the inside?
I'm fine. I'm going to feel fine. I'm a man.
You won't have nothing left then, Rosalie.
Mama, I'm going to feel fine. I'm gonna look that son of a bitch in the eye. I'm gonna say, that's your neighborhood out there. You got the right to have it like you want it. You got the right to keep it like you want it. Just write the check and the house is yours. Yeah, and I'm gonna say, you people, hey, you just put the money in my hand and you won't have to live next to this bunch of stinking niggas. And maybe I just get down on my knees and I say, hey, Captain, Captain Bossman. Yes, sir, great white father. Hey, JC, you just give me some of that money for God's sake. Yeah, and you ain't gonna have to worry about us moving in your white neighborhood. I'm gonna feel fine.
That is not a man. That is nothing but a toothless rat.
Yes, death done come in this here house. Done come walking in my house on the lips of my children. You what's supposed to be my beginning again. You what's supposed to be my harvest. How did we get to this here place? You mourning your brother?
He's no brother of mine.
What did you say?
I said that individual in that room is no brother of mine.
That's what I thought you said. You feeling like you better than he is today, yeah? What's that you tell him a minute ago, that he wasn't no man, yeah? You done give him up for me? You done wrote his epitaph too, like the rest of the world? Who gives you that privilege?
Will you be on my side for once? You saw what he just did, Mama. You saw him down on his knees. Wasn't it you who always taught me to despise any man who would do that? Do what he's going to do?
Yes, I taught you that, me and your daddy. But I thought I taught you something else, too. I thought I taught you to love him.
Love him? There's nothing left to love.
There is always something left to love. And if you ain't learned that, you ain't learned nothing. Have you cried for that boy today? I don't mean for yourself and the family because we lost the money. I mean for him. What he's been through and what is done to him. Child, when do you think is the time to love somebody the most? When they done good and made things easy for everybody? Well, that ain't the time at all. It's when he's at his lowest and can't believe in himself because the world done whipped him so. When he starts to measure somebody. Measure him right, child. Measure him right. Make sure you done taken into account what hills and valleys he done come through before he gets to wherever he is.
It's downstairs. The truck just pulled up.
Are they, baby? They downstairs?
Hello.
He's here.
Well, I was certainly glad to hear from you people. Life can really be so much simpler than people let it be most of the time. Well, now, with whom do I negotiate? You, Mrs. Younger, or your son? Just some official papers, Sonny.
Travis, you go downstairs.
No. Travis, you stay right here. And you make him understand what you're doing, Walter Lee. You teach him good, like Willie Harris taught you. You show him where our five generations done come to. Go ahead, son.
Yes, Mr. Yeah,
I mean, I have worked as a chauffeur most of my life. My wife here does domestic work in people's kitchens. So does my mother. I mean, we are plain people.
Yes,
and
I see,
my
Mr.
father, well, he was a laborer most of his life.
Yes, I understand.
Almost beat a man to death once because this man called him a bad name or something. You know what I mean?
No, I'm afraid I don't.
Yeah, well, I mean, what I'm saying is that we come from people who had a lot of pride. I mean, we are very proud people. And my sister there is going to be a doctor. And we are very proud.
Well, I'm sure that's very nice.
And what I'm telling you is that we called you over here to tell you that we are very proud and that this, Travis, come here. This is my son. And he makes the sixth generation of our family in this country. And we have all thought about your offer.
Well, good.
And we have decided to move inside our house. Because my father earned it for us. Brick by brick. We don't want to make no trouble for nobody. Or fight no causes. We're going to try to be good neighbors. That's all we have to say about that. We don't want your money.
Take it then you've decided to occupy.
That's what the man said.
Then I would like to appeal to you, Mrs. Younger. You're older and wiser and understand things better, I'm sure.
I'm afraid you don't understand. My son say we was moving and ain't nothing left for me to say. You know how young people is nowadays, mister. Can't do a thing with them.
But
goodbye.
Well, if you're
that final about it, there's nothing left for me to say. I sure hope you people know what you're getting into. Walter Lee, fix your tie and tuck your shirt in.
Look like somebody's hoodlum. Mm.
Lord of mercy, what did I do with my plan? Y'all start on down now. Travis, baby, don't go empty-handed. Ruth, what did I do with that box with my skillets?
I'm going to make us the biggest dinner we ever had tonight.
Mama.
Benita, remember with them stockings, child? Pull them things up.
Mama, Arthur Guy asked me to marry him today and go to Africa.
He did? You ain't old enough to marry nobody.
Darling, please. There ain't no bale of cotton. Hand it so I can sit in it again. I had that chair for 25 years.
To go to Africa, Mama? Doctor in Africa.
Yes, baby.
Africa? What do you want you to go to Africa for?
To practice there.
Girl, if you don't get all them silly ideas out your head, you better marry yourself a man with some loot.
What have you got to do with who I marry?
Plenty. Now, I think George Murchison...
George Murchison! I wouldn't marry George Murchison if he was Adam and I was Eve.
Yeah, they something all right, my children.
Yeah, they something. Let's go, Lena.
All right, honey. Ruth, yeah. He finally come to manhood today, didn't he? Kind of like a rainbow after the rain.
Yes, Lena.
Y'all, come on now. These people charge us about an hour.
You go on down, honey. I'll be down directly.
Next Tuesday night at 9, Frontline takes an inside look at the historic presidential campaign of the Reverend Jesse Jackson. We'll examine his triumphs and his troubles in Running with Jesse, Tuesday at 9 on TV 25.